We also know that the Palestinian Red Crescent, the equivalent of the Red Cross, was not allowed access. And for 1.5 hours, as you saw in that inexplicable video, Ahmed was left writhing and bleeding out.
I lost my son in this city, right in this West Haven, on January 15th. It was very devastating. Wouldn't like any family or any mother to ever receive this kind of message. Very painful.
Hello, my name is Stanley Heller. Welcome to The Struggle. Another murder in Palestine. A man who is on his way to a beauty parlor to pick up his sister who was to be married. He was a cousin of Noura Erakat, who has spoken many times on Democracy Now, but understandably never was she more upset or angry.
Israeli officers on Tuesday shot dead a Palestinian man at a checkpoint in the occupied West Bank as he was on his way to pick up his sister, who is set to be married that last night. A warning to our viewers, this story contains graphic footage. The video from the scene shows 27-year-old Ahmed Erakat bleeding but still alive on the street where he was shot. He's the nephew of senior Palestinian official Saeb Erakat, the secretary general of the Palestine Liberation Organization, who said his nephew was, quote, murdered in cold blood, and wrote in a tweet that Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu is responsible for his death. Ahmed Erakat's family said he was killed while on his way to a beauty salon to pick up his sister and his mother. But Israeli authorities claim he tried to run over an officer at a checkpoint in the Palestinian village of Abu Dis, east of Jerusalem. His family rejects the allegations, is calling for Israeli authorities to release security footage. Ahmed himself was also due to be married soon. His killing comes nearly a month after another Palestinian man was killed in similar circumstances near Ramallah, also in the West Bank, and as Netanyahu plans to start annexing nearly a third of the occupied West Bank next month. For more, we're joined by Ahmed Erakat's cousin, Noura Erakat, who's a Palestinian human rights attorney and legal scholar, assistant professor at Rutgers University, author of Justice for Some, Law and the Question of Palestine. Noura, our condolences to you and your family. This is such a terrible time for you. We so deeply appreciate you're able to join us. This is just hours after your cousin was killed. Can you describe the circumstances under which you understand he died?
Thank you, Amy. Thank you, Juan. And to the viewers, I haven't had a chance to speak to his parents, so I want to start out by saying, صباح الخير أم فيصل وأبو فيصل وخالته أم زياد ولكل العيلة يسلم رأسكم وأنا متأسفة كتير. We understand the circumstances to be what people know. Ahmed was on his way from Abu Dis to Bethlehem to pick up his sister from a hair salon for her wedding. Her mom was there with her. You know, on the way to the hair salon, he passed through a checkpoint separating Bethlehem from Abu Dis through a known roadway, back roadway, a dangerous one known as Wadi Nar, or Valley of Fire. There is a steep decline between this checkpoint on the road. And what we understand is that Ahmed lost control of his car or was confused while he was in his car. That was all it took to have a knee-jerk reaction for the car to jerk a little bit and immediately to cause the soldiers to open fire on him multiple times. Note that these soldiers who are fully armed at this checkpoint are behind barriers, are not actually out in the open, and then left Ahmed to bleed for 1.5 hours. We also understand that his father, Abu Faisal, was there pleading with the Israeli soldiers to let him access his son. We also know that the Palestinian Red Crescent, the equivalent of the Red Cross, was not allowed access. And for 1.5 hours, as you saw in that inexplicable video, Ahmed was left writhing and bleeding out. without the ability to care for him. And what is very obvious is the ease and the callousness with which this happened, the way that it's normalized completely. And there's a Palestinian, there's a line, a queue of Palestinian cars. And the one filming this, who's praying over Ahmed as he's dying, should remind us that even those Palestinians who are bearing witness to this are subject to a state of forced helplessness. They are not even allowed to help Ahmed in that moment. I want to just bring up something, Amy, to the audience before I address Israel's vicious, dangerous, and disgusting allegations that this was a car ramming, and raise three questions for the audience that's paying attention right now. Right now, is one, why is Abu Dis, where Ahmed and my family is from, so severely underdeveloped that he has to travel outside to one of the big Palestinian cities in order to get his sisters from a hair salon? What is the cause of that underdevelopment? Number two, I want to ask the audience to think about the biggest Palestinian city and commercial center to Abu Dis is Jerusalem. Abu Dis is a suburb of Jerusalem and has been cut off from it by the apartheid wall. Why can't Palestinians, why couldn't my family get to Jerusalem and instead have to travel to Bethlehem? And number three, and so importantly, why is there a checkpoint between Bethlehem and Abu Dis, two Palestinian cities? Why are there checkpoints anywhere? Just think about those questions as we answer this broader question of the context that Ahmed was killed in.
And Noura, that last point that you, first of all, my deepest condolences to you and your family. But I wanted to precisely ask that question. What are these checkpoints that are within Palestinian territory that apparently are not even near any Israeli settlements? How many of them are there? And what is the justification for them from Israel's perspective?
Thank you for that question. The Palestinian checkpoint, the checkpoints that divide Palestinians from one another and that separate them from their homes, are an invention of the peace process. In 1995, the Palestinian West Bank and Gaza were separated into three jurisdictions, A, B, and C, demarking what was under full Israeli civil and military control and what was under some shared control. Note that Area C, or 60% of the West Bank, is the largest area. It is what is now being marked for annexation, and it is what came under full Israeli civil and security control. The checkpoints that are erected are meant to police Palestinians from traveling from amongst their cities and with one another, and they are placed precisely to divide Palestinians from one another in order to delimit and to quell any kind of national cohesion and uprising. They are also set up because they are policing Palestinians who are not to travel next to settlements, around settlements, through settlements, which are all built on confiscated Palestinian lands. And you ask, you know, sometimes these settlements, these checkpoints are built around places where there are no settlements, but there will be. But there will be. All of Palestinian territory is marked for Israeli settlement and is marked for the removal of Palestinians. Palestinians have been steadily removed from their homes. They are demolished. Roads are built over them for Israelis only. Settlements are built on top of them. And Palestinians are ever contained into smaller and smaller tracts of land that the Trump administration just revealed in January will become their permanent Bantustans or reservations, where they will be able to practice autonomy, which or derivative sovereignty, but never a form of freedom, and they will be forever dominated. I want to switch really quick because this is the concern of the family. In the aftermath of Ahmed's murder, Israel immediately started a propaganda campaign blaming Ahmed for his own death and alleging that he tried to ram his car into the checkpoint. This is a lie. This is an incredibly hurtful lie, but it's a systematic lie that Israel tells as it kills Palestinians and blames them for their own death. What we know is that Israel has done this systematically. We know that they have used this. As people have said, this is prepared and ready argument. We know that from May to October 2018, Israel killed 267 Palestinians in Gaza who were unarmed, that was supported by the Israeli police, by the Israeli military establishment, its political establishment, and it was rubber stamped. rubber-stamped as a shoot-to-kill policy by the Israeli High Court. We know among those murdered was paramedic 21-year-old Rezana Najjar, who had her hands up, was wearing a paramedic vest, and was shot in the back. When she was killed, the Israeli military released a doctored video claiming that Rezan said, "I am a human shield." What they failed to play was the rest of Rezan's clip, where she said, "I am a human shield on the here on the line, being a protective human shield, saving the injured." But the Israeli military doctored that video to say that she was a human shield for Hamas. And guess what? The entire world stopped asking questions. The moment you say Hamas, the moment you say Palestinian violence, the moment you say Palestinian resistance, it's as if we expect that to be a carte blanche to kill as many Palestinians as possible. They did it with Rezan. They did it with Iyad al-Halaq. They did it with Ahmed yesterday. And right now, the family is demanding that Ahmed's body, his corpse, be returned. It is being withheld as a form of collective punishment. We are also demanding that the home be protected, because Israel has a policy of demolishing homes of Palestinians they consider alleged assailants without, of course, any kind of trial. We are demanding that the footage be released and atone and apologize and address the systematic violence. It bears to note that in 2017, the Human Rights Council at the UN examined the cases of Israel's systematic killings of Palestinians and concluded, quote, that Israel often used lethal force against Palestinians on mere suspicion or as a precautionary measure. Israeli soldiers kill Palestinians as precautionary measure. And the rest of the world accepts this because of how used to the loss of Palestinian lives we have become numb to. This is normalized. This amount of killing is normalized. And this is the context in which Ahmed now, his family is fighting for justice in his name, and is also mourning his life at the same time.
Noura Erakat, as you describe Ahmed, he was picking up his mom and his sister. His sister was going to be married last night. He was picking them up from the salon. His sister Iman fainted when she heard what had taken place, and he himself was going to be married in just a few weeks?
Indeed. So the other part of the story that doesn't add up, and frankly, one of the things about this is you're telling us these details, Amy, right? And so most listeners would think naturally, why would a young man, 27 years old, with his own T-shirt business, who's incredibly happy and smiling on the day of his sister's wedding, plan an attack against an Israeli checkpoint, which is basically a suicide mission? Why would he do that? Normal people will ask that, and normal and pathetic people will say it is impossible. And yet, because of the dehumanization of Palestinians and the racism with which our stories are cloaked, there are some who might say, yeah, it's possible. Palestinians are driven by a hatred for Jews and are basically born in order to kill. As former Justice Minister Ayad Shak had said, Palestinian mothers should be killed because they birth snakes. This is the discourse of the highest people in office in Israel, not of the random extremists, but of its representatives who represent them to the world, this so-called only democracy. And yes, Ahmed was incredibly proud of the home he had furnished and prepared for his wife to be. They had shared pictures of him in his home and had so much to live for and deserved to live and deserves justice and deserves our support in demanding justice and demanding accountability. This is not about one bad Israeli soldier, just as it's not about one bad cop ever. This is a system. It is an apartheid system. It is a settler colonial system that enshrines Jewish Israeli supremacy as a matter of law and policy on an international scale. And it is one that marks Palestinians for removal, exile, or death. And it is done with the full, unequivocal diplomatic, financial, military support of the United States and with the complicity of the international community. So it bears upon us to respond in this moment by supporting the Palestinian call for freedom, by doing the little that we can, by engaging in boycott, divestment, and sanctions for Ahmed, for Razan, for Iyad, oppose the annexation, to oppose apartheid, to fight for freedom.
Noura Erakat, we want to thank you for being with us again. Our condolences to your family. Noura is a Palestinian human rights attorney, legal scholar, colleague of Juan's over at Rutgers, assistant professor at Rutgers University, and author of Justice for Some, Law and the Question of Palestine. Over 1,000 European MPs have written a letter opposing Israel's plan to annex parts of the occupied West Bank. Also, the final tweet, one of the tweets of Noura Erakat, our guest, after Ahmed died, they left him to bleed out like this for 1.5 hours. His name is Ahmed. He deserved to live. He deserved to dance tonight with his family to celebrate his sister. He deserved to dance at his wedding to nurture family, to live. This is not a picture of Ahmed, but of Israel's ugliness, she wrote.
Wednesday, June 24th, was to be the 20th birthday of Mubarak Soulemane. However, he was killed on January 15th in West Haven by a Connecticut state trooper. So the day was a mixture of sad memorial and birthday social event as scores gathered in West Haven. Neither Governor Lamont nor Mayor Rossi has made a word of criticism of any of the police involved or even explained what happened. Soleimani's sister and mother were among those who gave short remarks.
Because we want to hold Norwalk Department accountable, West Haven Department accountable, as well as the state trooper, Brian North. Apparently, the investigation is still underway. We are awaiting those results from the state attorney. So we just want to make it known that we are not going to be silenced and that we will continue the fight. So with your guys' help as allies, it means the world to my family and I. And I just want to say, happy birthday, Mubarak. So, happy birthday, Mubarak. So, there's one thing I ask for you guys today, to mingle.
My name is Omo Mohammed. I'm Mubarak Suleiman's mother. On January 15, I lost a son. Very sadly, very emotionally, I was out of the country when this happened. I lost my son in this city, right in this West Haven. On January 15th, it was very devastating. Wouldn't like any family or any mother to ever receive this kind of message. Very painful. We are fighting for justice, and we all need your support for justice. We're still waiting for the investigation for the state attorney, so we need your support. Justice for Mubarak. Thank you very much. Thank you all for coming.
The city and state are being sued for $10 million, and whatever the settlement may be, the citizens of the state will pay the penalty in taxes. We did learn one thing, though, during the last week. It seems that sergeants among the Connecticut State Police have a base pay of $100,000 and can make up to $250,000 more in overtime. At the event for Soulemane, I heard one man talking about fighting that took place just before the removal of the Columbus statue in neighboring New Haven. This is part of the interview I did with him.
It was 50-2 at first, and then a newspaper caught the whole thing, put it online, it went viral instantly, 170,000 views last time I checked, and people just started showing up. And then it became 200 more Black Lives Matter supporters of all colors, but 200 good people that took a stand against what that statue represented. And I even told the Italian people there, I do not want to erase your history. If he means something to you guys, then please, by all means, continue to celebrate him. But celebrate him in a museum. Celebrate him at home. Get him out of our face, because what he means to us is a lot worse than what he means to you. And we don't want to look our oppressors in the eyes anymore. We have to look our oppressors in the eyes every day. Every time you see a cop, that is our oppressor. We're taking a stand against him. And again, we don't want superiority, only equality.
When you see Columbus, what does that mean to you?
I am Puerto Rican and I am Ecuadorian. You can look at me and see that I come from a native indigenous background. My people only speak Spanish because Christopher Columbus came and colonized our islands. We only became a Spanish country or whatever we are because of that man, because of the genocide that he committed, because of the slavery, because of the rape, because of the pilgrimage, because of all the disgusting things that man represents. So when I see him, oh, I see my enemy. I see a man that kidnapped my ancestors, that mistreated them. I see a man that changed the identity of who my people are, because we're not Hispanic. Puerto Rico was created by colonization. We are indigenous, we are black, and we are Spaniard. That is what we consist of. Christopher Columbus means everything that this country should be against when I look at him.
I did see video of what happened in Wooster Square in New Haven later. Los was not kidding. It was a tense and violent situation. From what I've read about history, Columbus was pretty much unknown in North America until the 1700s. Italian Americans adopted him as a hero only about 130 years ago, at a time when they were facing prejudice, attacks, and even lynchings in this country. The crazy thing about Columbus is that he never set foot in North America. And if in his day you had called him Italian, he would probably have been mystified. He was from Genoa, which was an independent republic north of Corsica, and was a independent republic for 800 years. Anyway, if you have heroes like Marconi, Toscanini, Fermi, Sinatra, Scorsese, Fauci, Madonna, Alyssa Milano, Fiorello, LaGuardia, and Yogi Berra, you don't need a brute like Columbus. We need to take advantage of whatever democratic rights we have, including speaking out to school boards and city councils. Look at the big splash this man made in his talk in Baton Rouge, Louisiana.
I want to go to a video that has gone viral. We're turning to Baton Rouge, Louisiana, where a video of a well-known community activist calling out members of the school board for their racism has gone viral. The board was meeting to discuss a resolution to change the name of Lee High School, named after Confederate General Robert E. Lee. This is Gary Chambers Jr. addressing the board member, Connie Bernard, after he noticed she was online shopping during the meeting. Bernard can be seen walking out as Chambers speaks.
So I had intended to get up here and talk about how racist Robert E. Lee was, but I'm gonna talk about you, Connie. Sitting over there shopping while we talking about Robert E. Lee. This is a picture of you shopping while we talking about racism and history in this country. Only white members of this board got up while we were up here talking too, because you don't give a damn, and it's clear. But I'm gonna tell you what the slaves, my ancestors, said about Robert E. Lee, since you don't know history, sister. Let me tell you that they said when he got the plantation, after he got off the field where 27,000 people died at Gettysburg, Connie, Robert E. Lee was a brutal slave master. Not only did when he whooped the slaves, he said, lay it on them hard. After he said, lay it on them hard, he said, put brine on them, sort of burn them. That's what Robert E. Lee did. And you set your arrogant self in here and sit on there shopping while the pain and the hurt of the people of this community is on display, because you don't give a damn and you should resign. You should have resigned 2 years ago when you choked a white man in his house. You should have resigned 2 weeks ago when you got on TV and said foolishness. And you should walk out of here and resign and never come back, because you are the example of racism in this community. You are horrible. Now to the rest of the board. You have an obligation to the people of this community. And 81% of them are black. And do you need a Klan rally outside, Mr. Golday, before you end it? Because holding it up means that you put that building in jeopardy. You do, sir. Because all over the country, they're burning stuff down. And black folks in this city have stood with protesters. I ain't seen you elected officials out there with them, making sure that nothing goes south in Baton Rouge. It's been folks in this community who give a damn. Not just when it's comfortable, but every time. And 4 years ago, we came down here. Mr. Drake, they say you a good man. Be a good man. Black folks say you a good man. White folks say you a good man. Your legacy is attached to tonight, brother. Your legacy. Now, let me say to the black members of the board, it's the most solidarity I've seen out of y'all in forever. Let's keep it at. Let's stand on this moving forward, because we don't need to apologize for Connie, Evelyn. She showed you who she was when she was sitting next to you while you were talking shopping. You don't need another example. Now, when do we as Baton Rouge stop being in 1856? If you want to name the building after somebody, how about PBS Pinchback, the first black governor of the state of Louisiana, when he was governor during Reconstruction? You want another name? Oscar Dunn, who was the lieutenant governor of the state of Louisiana in the 1860s, that gave the right for Darius Landis and Don Collins and Evelyn Ware Jackson and Tramell Howard to get here. You want to name it after somebody from Reconstruction? Name it after the people who fought for abolition of slavery. If you want to name it after somebody, honor the right people, the people who are on the right side of history. But it's your ancestor that the school is named after. So you're holding on to your heritage. But we built this joint for free. And we've done begging you to do what's right.
Thank you, sir.
That's Gary Chambers addressing the East Baton Rouge Parish School Board. On Thursday, they voted unanimously to form a special committee to come up with alternative names for Lee High School.
That's our program for today. Stay safe, folks, but stay active. I'm Stanley Heller for The Struggle.